Thanks, everyone. That was a wonderful talk by Judge Smith. There'll be a lot for us to refer to later on, both in the talks and afterward at lunch. I'm now going to very briefly introduce our moderator, Steve Menashi, who will then introduce our speakers. Each will have 20 minutes, and then we'll have 20 minutes for Q&A. Stephen Menashi is the Koch-Searle Fellow at NYU School of Law. Previously, he worked at Kirkland & Ellis, and also clerked for Justice Samuel Alito, and also Judge Douglas Ginsburg on the U.S. Court of Appeals. He's a graduate of Stanford Law School, and we're very pleased to have him moderating the panel today.
Hi. Well, thank you very much. So as Anthony said, we're going to hear from each of our presenters for 20 minutes each, and then we'll go to questions from you. So first up is going to be Dean Daniel Rodriguez. You have a very detailed bio in your brochure, so I'll just give a brief introduction, which is that Dean Rodriguez is the Harold Washington Professor of Law and Dean of the Northwestern University School of Law, a position he's held since January 2012. And previously, he's taught at the University of Texas at Austin, the University of San Diego, where he also served as dean, and the University of California at Berkeley. He also recently completed service as president of the American Association of Law Schools. With that, Dean Rodriguez.
Sure. Thank you. First couple thank yous, I'm sure will be echoed appropriately by the other speakers and panelists. Thank you, Anthony Sanders, for the invitation, and the students, part of the NYU Law and Liberty Journal, and folks at NYU, and all sorts of folks, anyone who was responsible. For those who have ever been in a significant administrative role, and certainly a dean, as Richard has, maybe some others, you'll appreciate an honor and a relief it is to be able to be part of a panel and engage with issues much more weighty than, well, I won't fill you in, but the issues that occupy most of my day. And so the mea culpas could get large, and I'll spare you most of them, but I certainly can't resist a couple of them. One is my paper, my contribution, which I'll talk about the police power, does interface and intersect with some issues of economic liberties. It's not primarily about it, although hopefully I'll have at least a couple sentences to try to tie the themes together. So mea culpa for presenting a paper that really focuses on one aspect of state constitutional law more generally, and the other mea culpa, of course, is that it's very much a working draft, and I look forward to getting your insights, because I hope to turn it into something more than that. And that's why in my few minutes I really want to frame some of the issues and then end up with some questions rather than anything like profound insights about the police power, which is ubiquitous, and I say maybe too cleverly is inscrutable and irrepressible. Focusing on the irrepressible part, let me just say the brute fact, which is the police power exists as a omnibus power in all of the state constitutions and always has. Not because I say so, but because really at the root and the heart of our state constitutional tradition, going back, of course, to the original state constitutions and continuing through various state constitutions created at the time that these states were created, they've all had hardwired into them, sometimes textually explicitly, but where not textually explicit, hardwired and embedded into the very DNA, as it were, of these state constitutions, is the basic idea that state government, particularly the state legislature, has the plenary power to regulate health, safety, and welfare. It's particularly interesting when you juxtapose it with our national or federal constitutional tradition, which says quite deliberately, and when I say says, I should say not particularly textually, based on a plethora of Supreme Court decisions and legal theory, that the national government lacks such a power. It doesn't have plenary power to regulate health, safety, and welfare. Indeed, if there's a core principle of American federalism, it's basically that. As we say in the state constitutional business, those of us who think and write about it, and we're asked to juxtapose the state constitutional tradition with the federal constitutional tradition, what quickly jumps to mind is the proposition, and there's even a clever phrase, that the national constitution, the United States Constitution, is a document of grant, and the state constitutions are documents of limit. What that means in plain English is the national government has only those powers delegated to it by the Constitution. I'll leave aside, of course, what's interesting, right, doctrinally, which is what it means, is that express delegated, what's the scope of the necessary and proper clause, all to one side, and simply, again, make the point that the national government, Congress, the executive branch, the courts have only that power delegated to it by the document. State constitutions, by contrast, are documents of limit, and thus state legislature has plenary power, limited only by, you know, put only in quotes, by the terms and conditions of the state constitution, and of course, the supremacy of federal government, where the supremacy clause covers it. So sort of my task in this paper and in my remarks is to try to convince you you ought to be interested in the police power and thinking more theoretically and more globally about state police power, despite the fact that it's really been, as I say, not to exaggerate it too much, nearly 100 years since scholars spent hundreds and hundreds of pages really grappling with the contours and the theory underlying the police power. So Ernst Freund's book on the police power was from 1914. Thomas, what's that? 04, okay, maybe there was a second edition. Even more, so 10 years even more languishing than I might have thought. And so it's sort of time for a return to some serious attention on the state, police power. By the way, just as a footnote, there has been in the last several years a fair amount of interesting attention on the federal police power. So Randy Barnett in 2004 wrote a quite important article, and others have as well, about the proper, I think the title was something to the effect of the proper scope of the police power. That was about the police power, but the gist of that analysis in that article, as you may recall, was about whether or not how we ought to think about federal constraints on the police power in light of modern developments, and indeed in light of original. And that's not my topic, as interesting as it is. It's about whether there's anything in our state constitutional tradition, state constitutional law and theory, that bears on the nature and the scope of the police power. So I said a couple sentences, and I'll just say a couple sentences more about how this debate is situated in larger concerns about American federalism. Again, remember the slogans: federal constitution is a document of grant, state constitutions are documents of limit. The powerful sort of textual message in the United States Constitution that of course illustrates that principle is the 10th Amendment, right, which delegates powers. I'm not gonna like Judge Smith ask Richard to cite it by verse, but I'm sure he could do that as well. So I'll simply paraphrase, say, right, all powers not delegated to the national government are delegated respectively to the states or to the people. So if one says, tell me where in the United States Constitution there is the notion, the principle, that the states have a police power, probably the closest that comes to mind is the 10th Amendment itself. But that's, of course, just the beginning of the inquiry, because what we want to know, what I want to know, and what I suggest is a topic of very worthwhile theoretical and doctrinal debate, is what in the world is the scope of the state police power once those powers have been delegated, as the 10th Amendment makes clear. So, again, state constitutions are documents of limits, so what are those limits? I want to mention again and bracket and put to one side federal limits. There's much to say about that. As I mentioned, there's a literature that is not 110 years old about that, but it's more modern, and it has to do with such matters of federal supremacy, the scope of the Commerce Clause, all the sorts of bells and whistles issues that make federalism so very interesting, both as a matter of doctrine, as a matter of theory. What I want to focus on are the rights that emerge from the state constitutions, and those are of two sorts. Right there, and I want to suggest, maybe a little provocatively, that there might be a third source of restriction that grows out of the police power itself. But let me come back to the black letter. There are rights restrictions. Judge Smith talked about a number of them. There is a number to add to those, that is to say, state constitutional rights that limit the scope of the police power. So to put it in kind of homely terms, sure, the state legislature has plenary power to regulate health, safety, and welfare, but that goes only so far as the state constitutional limits in the Bill of Rights or in the various rights limits go to permit the state legislature to have that authority. And of course, there are a number of individual rights limits embedded in state constitutions that limit, restrict, and regulate the scope of the state's police power. There are structural limits, and I'll say a couple words about that. In the particular, what's fascinating from a historical perspective, I'm not an historian, nor do I play one on TV, but historians remind us, Professor Ely's work and many others, is one of the fascinating periods that really of American constitutional history and political history that shed extraordinary light on the juxtaposition between broad state legislative power on the one hand and significant structural limitations and the exercise of that power is not the framing in the 18th century, but it's the progressive era, where you get an enormous number of reforms to state constitutions, you get some new constitutions, and you get this panoply of structural limits on state legislative power. A couple words more on that in a moment. So I want to suggest, and I say this in the paper, perhaps not particularly eloquently, to understand these structural limits, these third types of limits, the first being federal limits, the second being individual rights, the third being structural limits. To understand structural limits, you have to understand or ought to understand the nature and scope of the power granted. Okay? So I want to make a couple claims. I'll leave it to you to decide how provocative or well-supported they are, either by the history or the theory or some combination of both. So again, the state police power in historical context. The federal government has, in fact, point of fact, a fairly limited role in terms of the restriction on how the states exercise their police power, although they certainly have something to say about displacement of state sovereignty or state power through the exercise of national legislative authority. Again, a big topic that is for the most part outside the scope of my analysis. And they have a lot to say, the feds, right? The U.S. Constitution does, about the scope of individual rights and the limits then on the state's ability to regulate health, safety, and welfare. But nonetheless, has been well illustrated, indeed hot off the presses, Richard makes this point in his own paper, that whatever the vast scope of national legislative authority and the story of the New Deal and the Great Society and the Warren Court, the 1-2 punch of broad, expansive legislative and administrative authority, and the other punch of the expansive approval of such national authority by Supreme Court jurisprudence, with all that, states and local governments matter a heck of a lot. To use a non-legal phrase, right? The whole range of of regulation. Let me walk back from that. A vast range, not the whole range, but a vast range of regulatory authority in the area of education, public health, criminal law enforcement, so-called morals regulation, family law, et cetera, is governed in the main by states. Sometimes delegated, certainly to local governments. To a great extent, sometimes delegated, as in California, remarkably, but also in some other states, to so-called special purpose governments, sometimes to quasi-governmental associations like common interest developments, often to regulatory agencies. But those are not caveats to the general point. They're illustrations to the general point, which is the state government and local governments are in our business in a very ubiquitous way, and the New Deal didn't change that. Nor did the Great Society. So the stakes of having an appreciation for the scope and the nature of state authority is still great, indeed. I mentioned the progressive era in passing, and I want to mention it here too, not much more than in passing, to get to this point, which is about structure. Many of the structural provisions and structural limits on state legislative authority grow out of the progressive era. Progressive era is fascinating for a lot of reasons, but it also has a certain I can't do better than fascinating. So the progressive era brings us, on the one hand, a significant expansion in state regulatory authority, right? That story is well told. But it also brings with it an enormous amount of skepticism about state legislatures, not about state governance writ large, but about state legislatures. So the powerful reforms in state constitutionalism in the period of time roughly from the late 19th century into the early 20th century is mostly directed like a laser beam at a significant and growing skepticism concern about broad state legislative power. Tim Sandifer in his question in the earlier panel alluded to that in the context of railroads. But there's a million stories in the Naked City, or in the Naked States, about emerging concerns on the part of the populace, the people, about the exercise of state legislative power. So what does that mean in practice? Out of these progressive era reforms, you get balanced budget limits and debt limits imposed in state constitutions, the likes of which we never see at the national government level, but still in all are very significant restrictions on the ability of state governments to undertake debt. You see a fragmentation of state political power with the expansion of executive branch authority, right, and the increase in the power given to governors, with an important qualification or caveat, which is just as reformers expand the scope of executive power vis-a-vis the state legislature, they also fragment executive power. And so what you get out of the progressive era, famously, is the plural executive. Right? Directly elected governors, yes, but also directly elected attorney generals and any number of other executive officials. So it is a mixed bag, right? The executive branch is given broader authority to combat political problems and corruption at the state legislative level, but they are the executive branch in some important respects is defanged by the fragmentation of executive power at the state level. You get from the progressive era the public purpose requirements embedded in state constitutions, right? Alongside, not to displace, but alongside public use requirements in eminent domain and the like. You get prohibitions on special legislation, right, that also exist and persist alongside equal protection clauses, often, as Judge Smith noted, in identical language to the federal constitution. But special legislation may be belts and suspenders, but nonetheless, they are specific restrictions on the ability of the state legislature to, say, parcel out goodies to New York City or to Houston, Texas, or other areas without making more generally applicable. And two important, in some ways neglected, provisions you get out of the progressive era, although in 1904, Ernst Freund and others write about this, is the development of municipal home rule, the creation of, in some states, a sort of imperium in imperio system, as in California, where local governments are given plenary authority, sovereignty, in the areas of so-called local and municipal affairs. And even in those states like New York and elsewhere that don't have an imperium and imperio system, there is a muscularity, you might say, to local governance and local government power that creates that emerges directly out of the progressive era and progressive era reforms. Indeed, it's Professor Freund himself that becomes, as one of his important hobbies, develops the modern municipal home rule movement. And the other is initiative lawmaking, right? The ballot box, direct lawmaking, in places like California and Colorado, a lot of the Western states, an enormous amount of power given to people. All right, so away from the detail. These are imperfect restrictions, to be sure, these progressive era restrictions, for sort of three distinct reasons. Number one, they fragment power in the ways that I've described, but they don't, by their own terms, limit power. So one cannot see, I would suggest, these important historical developments from that era as weakening the state's police power to regulate health, safety, and welfare. That's a much more complicated picture. So one shouldn't conclude from the fragmentation of that power that there is, in some sense, a weakening government power. Libertarians should give 1.5 or at most 2 cheers to these particular reforms from the vantage point of the balance between public and private authority, right? Because the state legislature still moves on, thank you very much, with a very powerful regulatory authority, notwithstanding those provisions. Second, these incentives and this is a larger, longer story that would take us in a wonderful tour into public choice theory and the like, but I'll just simply say this. The incentives for the legislature to push the boundaries, right, of the exercise of power do not go away or even substantially dissipate in the face of these structural limits. Legislators continue to push hard on these particular powers. The fragmentation of executive authority gives them a window in which to do that. So the broad, expansive scope of state legislative power does not disappear, as you wouldn't expect it to disappear, given the strong incentives of legislators to continue to want to regulate. And third, to put it mildly, inconsistent judicial interpretations. Sure, there were special legislation provisions in state constitutions. Sure, there were balanced budget amendments. But as Richard's going to tell us in the context of modern times involving such important issues as pension reform and the like, courts found a way to escape the strictures of the so-called fiscal constitution, and they still do. So there's the parchment barriers, and there's the real world. And the real world has often overcome the various restrictions on paper on state legislative authorities. So let me suggest that we ought to think about other limits, is really the moral of my story. Structural limits and rights limits, to be sure, but for those of us concerned, I think the us includes a lot of folks in this room. I'm speaking, of course, with the banner of litigating for liberty in the background. So among us friends, those concerned with the very broad scope of the state police power should be thinking about limits other than economic liberties, individual rights limits, and also structural limits. So I want to just, sort of in conclusion, mention a couple ways of thinking about broader claims about the scope of the police power. And remember, I started out by saying, sort of somewhat banal fashion, we ought to think more about the state police power. So let me say something a little bit less banal than that. Number one, there ought to be a connection, as we think about theorizing about the police power, between regulatory objectives, as I say in the paper, and regulatory techniques, and the scope of the police power. We hear a lot, and there's written a lot, particularly from the economic analysis of the political economy of public law and politics, about the ways in which the federal constitution, and particularly legislative power under things like the Commerce Clause, were yoked to a particular economic story about the incapacity of the states and the necessity of having broad national power in order to overcome collective action problems. If you want to go all the way back, that, of course, was a story told in certainly eloquent terms by Madison and Hamilton. The language of the Virginia Plan, right, speaks of the incompetence of states and the need for a national authority over general welfare. In more modern times, one of my former colleagues and one of my former students, Bob Cooter and Neil Siegel, wrote a really clever article a couple of years ago in Stanford, I think it was, that talked about the kind of the collective action reasons and rationale, right, behind broad scope of Commerce Clause. So you're familiar with that story. But it's a story that ought to be told in the state constitutional context as well. Because it's one thing to defend national authority in order to regulate the externalities generated by self-interested states. But what is the case to be made from an economic perspective to limit the scope of state authority? The case I would suggest, the economic case, is rather powerful and in some ways parallels the national story. And maybe even more powerful because once you introduce state regulatory authority, you're dealing not only with the vertical challenges, right, collective action problem and externalities, but you're dealing with the horizontal challenges. And for all of the celebration, I say this with my voice with cynicism within it, for all the celebration of the literature on collaborative federalism over the last 20 or 25 years, and the celebration has reached a fever pitch. CEG, Heather Gherkin's foreword in the Harvard Law Review 5 years. This is the heyday of a celebration, even among strong nationalists, to this laboratories of experimentation idea, this sort of kumbaya notion of the states being able to engage in interstate compacts and have, as she puts it, federalism all the way down. The reality is a much more cold-hearted, cold-blooded story. So the question, I'll just throw out the question. The question is how we think about state police power in a world in which you have 50 state legislatures, each craving and battling for political influence and power within the structure and the scope of their state political systems. So that's why whatever theorizing and thinking we do should be tied and tethered very significantly to regulatory and techniques and objectives. I'm out of time, so let me just conclude on this point, which is a point I made rather elliptically, to put it mildly, in the paper. One of the features that Judge Smith, in his wonderful talk, just omitted entirely, not a criticism, just an observation, and I mentioned in my question, are positive rights. There, in fact, are quite a distinct tradition of rights in state constitutions, for better or worse. Right to education, not all states, but most states. Right to environmental protection, right to housing, the list goes on. So to the best of my knowledge, it has not yet been connected, or no one has made this connection, and I want to suggest a connection ought to be made, between, on the one hand, the positive rights, which are basically rights that call upon the government to engage in positive action in order to enforce rights that individuals have, the right to housing, leaving aside how enforceable they've been in the courts, and that's a mixed bag. So on the one hand, the existence of positive rights and the police power. Why ought not we to think about the police power and the scope of the police power as tied in important ways to how seriously, if at all, we should take the obligations on government to enforce these positive rights? You can think about the police power as expansive precisely because state governments and state legislatures have a significant obligation to protect positive rights. I'm not that sympathetic to that proposition as a normative matter, but I understand that connection, or at least a connection can be made. Or you can think about it the other way around, and that is that positive rights remain mostly parchment restrictions and regs, precisely because to really suppose and imagine that state legislatures have the authority to engage in what would inevitably be wealth redistribution, an expansion in the scope of not only regulatory authority or taxing authority, to provide people with the right to education, the right to housing, the right to environmental protection, is to really imagine a police power that was never contemplated at the time that the state constitutions were adopted, and frankly, never contemplated at the time of these progressive era reforms. I just want to stop by saying those questions are important questions to be asked. It's been at least 100 years in which they have been asked to a significant extent by the literature, and they relate, I'll finally get this phrase in, to economic liberties precisely because they involve significant and profound questions involving the economic capacity of the states and the economic wisdom of the states exercising the muscular police power that is connoted by the broad phrase.
Thank you very much. We'll hear next from Professor James Ely. Professor Ely is the Milton Underwood Professor of Law Emeritus and Professor of History Emeritus at Vanderbilt University, and is the author of several books, including The Guardian of Every Other Right, A Constitutional History of Property Rights, and is the co-editor of American Legal History, Cases and Materials. Professor Ely. Yeah.
It is indeed a pleasure to be here. I want to thank all the organizers and those who are kind enough to invite me to join you today. I think that the whole question of state constitutional law is an important one, and in particular, from my point of view, how state constitutional law impacts on the protection of contractual and property rights. My thesis of my paper can, I think, be simply stated. I would take the position that the state courts, interpreting in most cases state constitutional provisions, made a very significant contribution to the evolution of property rights before the Civil War. I do not contend that their record was perfect, and I will suggest some reservations about parts of their work, but I think that it cannot be overlooked how important the state courts were in this time period, in a time period in which the Supreme Court, aside from the famous contract clause cases, actually has surprisingly little to say about economic rights. I always found it difficult in my legal history courses to drive home to students how little the federal government did in this country before the Civil War, and how limited was the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court in many areas that would claim public attention during the antebellum era. By default, in a sense, most of the protection of property rights and contract rights would fall to the states. So, let's start. I think it's important to put in mind that the state constitutions preceded the national constitution. And several of the provisions that are in today the Constitution and Bill of Rights first surfaced in state constitutions, such as the Takings Clause in the Massachusetts Constitution, and surfaced in the Northwest Ordinance. Northwest Ordinance, in many respects, I think, can be viewed as a kind of constitutional document. It would furnish the basis for shaping new states in the old Northwest, and the Northwest Ordinance contained a due process clause, a takings clause, and a contract clause before any of these had, of course, surfaced in the national constitution. Now, because the national government did not exercise eminent domain power in this period. Indeed, there was some uncertainty as to whether they even had eminent domain power, and that would not be established by the Supreme Court until after the Civil War. Takings jurisprudence evolved at the state level. And I'd like to look at least briefly with you at four different areas in which state courts made important contributions. Number one, state courts emphatically established the fact that compensation must be paid when property was taken by the government. Aha, he may say, well, wouldn't that be in the state constitutions? Well, a number, starting with Massachusetts, did in fact contain a takings clause, but a number did not. As they revamped their constitutions, they did not in fact include a takings clause, but state courts moved into the gap and held almost uniformly that compensation must be paid. The leading opinion in many respects by Chancellor James Kent right here in New York established that the taking of property was compensable, and in reaching that result, Chancellor Kent looked at a variety of sources, including natural law, English common law, constitutions of other states, to conclude this really was a universal principle, and he was sure the lawmakers had just omitted it by mistake when they drafted the legislation that was at issue. His view was widely followed, to the point that antebellum legal commentators simply assumed that there was, in fact, a constitutional norm requiring the payment of just compensation, even if, for whatever reason, your state constitution had unfortunately omitted that provision. State courts also very early took a crack at what was public use. Now, this, of course, has been a much contested issue in recent years with Kelo and other decisions. They first wrestled with this in the context of the so-called mill acts, acts that authorized persons to flood, in essence, part of their neighbor's property to create a mill dam so there would be water power. Water power was extremely important, of course, to that founding generation. And the mill acts were invariably sustained and treated essentially as public utilities. Mills were highly regulated. They had to serve all comers. Their rates were regulated. I think it is not an unfair stretch at all to see that mills, certainly grist mills, were in fact public utilities. The more interesting and controversial question that would dominate much of the takings jurisprudence in the antebellum period was, of course, railroads. The emergence of railroads would create a whole host of novel problems. For a variety of reasons, most states chose not to engage in direct railroad building themselves, but to rely on private corporations to achieve that goal. It is also not unfair to say that there was enormous enthusiasm for railroads. A mania is probably not an unfair description. Railroads were seen as the path to prosperity, the path to the future. If you were on a railroad line, you would prosper. If you were not on a railroad line, you died. So, railroads, of course, had to acquire land for their operation, for their lines, and the question was raised whether it constituted public use. Here, the courts, to some extent, I think, following in the steps of the Mill Acts, the courts invariably answered yes. Railroads were public use. Why? Railroads were viewed as a kind of improved road whose services were open to everyone, since railroads had common carrier duties and were classed, indeed, often by legislation, if there's any doubt, as common carriers. Thus, railroads were available to use by the public, of course, on payment of the appropriate charge. Having reached this conclusion, however, the courts also emphasized, and this I think is an important part of the equation, that there was no taking for a private purpose. We could debate what is a public purpose, but there was no taking for a private purpose. Some scholars I think have made a rather strained argument that, well, there really is no limitation on taking for private purposes. It's only for public purposes that compensation is required. Seems to me that's totally backwards, and certainly is not historically justified. The courts were very clear that you could not take for a private purpose, even on the payment of compensation. You couldn't take for a private purpose. I think it's fair to say, if you look at the 19th century, the early 19th century cases as a whole, the courts pretty much took the view that public use meant either taking by the government a lighthouse, a road, or it meant taking by an entity who was under an obligation to serve the general public, that otherwise eminent domain was illegitimate. I'm not saying there was a great many cases, I'm not saying every case fits that formula, but I think the vast majority of cases do fit that formula, and so I think that is the prevailing norm. Okay, so we have a taking. What about just compensation? State courts were the first to take a crack at just compensation. Here, I think we have something of a mixed record. Sometimes courts spoke in terms of generous calculations of just compensation. Owners should be put in as good position as the owner would have been if the taking had never occurred. That was much easier to formulate than to carry out, however. And it leads us, I think, into one of the more litigated and bothersome questions of the antebellum period. To what extent could alleged benefits be offset against the just compensation that was required? To what extent, in other words, could a kind of implicit in-kind compensation satisfy? Well, some courts went further along this road than, speaking for myself at least, I might have liked. Indeed, even in a few cases, they suggested that the offset of benefits might be so substantial that there wouldn't be anything paid. Incredible, you got the land for free. Now that would be, in my mind, an eminent domain abuse. But the question of offsets raised a number of very difficult questions, and very troublesome ones, I think. Number one, the benefits were highly speculative. How did you know you were going to get such a benefit from the construction of the railroad? How did you even know the railroad was going to be built at all? A lot of those railroads failed. A lot of canals failed. And all people got was a mess in their backyard with no compensation of any sort. Secondly, it was very inequitable. Everybody in the community might get the benefit from the railroad coming to the community, but only one or two people had to give up their land. So there was a lot of sensitivity on the question of the unfairness, to say nothing of the speculative nature, of the offsets. Now, so how did states respond? Well, some states' courts, in point of fact, began to tighten up on this. The Supreme Court of Mississippi, I think, was actually one of the more emphatic. They took the position that just compensation meant payment in cash. Didn't mean benefits. Which I think they described as a moonshine value. I guess they know a bit about moonshine down there. Anyway, that they you had to pay in cash. That they were the most emphatic, but I think you can. But other states began to move in that direction, and at least two states in the antebellum period, Ohio and Iowa, passed constitutional amendments to bar offsets, brought the practice to a close. So there was at least movement to tighten the award of offsets, even if, to my mind, more could have been done. I can only say that the whole question of offsets continues to plague taking jurisprudence to the present. I've cited Richard's book to that effect in my notes. And I haven't even gone into the further mystification, whether you could offset special benefits or general benefits. If you really want to do permanent damage to your brain, read some of the treatises who try to explain the difference between special and general benefits, and which can be offset against which form of taking. But I don't have time to go into that. Read my book on railroads if you're that interested. Okay, what is a taking? We think we know, of course. We think we got an idea what a taking is. It's usually a physical appropriation of your property. But what about damages caused to your property by public works of various kinds? Street repair projects and this type of thing, or diverting water when you're building a bridge, this type of thing. But what is a taking? Well, here too, I think the record is more mixed than one might like. Some courts began to take the view these were consequential damages. They were just a consequence of an otherwise worthy public project, and therefore they did not amount to a taking. That type of damage did not amount to a taking, even though it could have been very severe, and it was a direct result of the project, but it was consequential. Consequential was rarely defined well, sort of meant incidental damage, I think, but it got to be kind of a all-purpose talisman. If you didn't want to compensate for somebody, you called the injury consequential, and that meant it kind of magically didn't have to be the result of receiving any compensation. So what do I say about the takings? I would say that it's a mixed bag, but state courts took the lead. They did insist upon the compensation norm. They did try to define a just compensation and public use. They took the first bite at the apple. And while maybe it wasn't a perfect result, I do think that they made a very important contribution to the story, because when the Supreme Court first begins to address these questions after the Civil War, they're not writing on a fresh slate. They have all this jurisprudence at the state level behind them. All right. Due process. The state constitutions typically use the older wording, which came from Magna Carta. You couldn't be deprived of life, liberty, and property except by the law of the land. That's usually been treated as more or less an equivalent of due process, but I do think that the older wording is worth noting, and that still appears in a number of state constitutions down to the present. The Supreme Court had very little occasion to address due process before the Civil War, but state courts did. And the most important of their decisions, the one right here in New York, the Wiedenhammer case, grew out of the Prohibition Movement, in which the New York Court of Appeals invalidated on due process grounds a prohibition statute that had the effect of saying that alcoholic beverages that you had in your possession could not be sold. I quote some of the language in my paper. The court is very clear that alcohol had long been treated as a form of property, and secondly, that the legislature could not simply destroy a form of property by passing a law saying it was now illegal to make a sale, because disposing of it was an important element of your property rights. That's generally been seen as the most important, the antebellum due process cases, and it's one that I think at least points toward a link between due process and protecting property and economic rights. Okay, I can't, since I've been spending years working on the history of the contract clause, I can't forbear without concluding with a few remarks about the contract clause. We all know that the Marshall Court, here's an area where, of course, there was a federal constitutional provision, and the Marshall Court rendered a number of very important decisions, putting a lot of teeth into the contract clause. That's not the purpose of my paper here. It is to remind you that the state courts heard far more contract clause cases than the federal court, and they too are an important part of the story. For example, they invalidated various kinds of debt relief law long before the Marshall Court even had an occasion to address the subject. So they were pretty rigorous on enforcing the contract clause with respect to private contracts, mortgages, and this type of thing, promissory notes, etc. When it comes to the state contracts, so-called public contracts, the things that were at issue in Fletcher and in Dartmouth College, I would say that on the whole, the state courts were very happy with Taney's decision in Charles River Bridge, that they should give a strict construction to a contract clause issues that pertain to corporate charters, because they were concerned that state power over the corporate entities was being whittled down. I also think I should note, because it relates to a Dan's paper a few moments ago, that you get also at the state court level the first appearance of the police power justification for overriding public contracts, that a state could not delegate away, or could not contract away, to use their phrase, its power over health and safety. The police power. Could not delegate away the police power. Now, usually in the 19th century, police power was phrased more often as health, safety, and morals. Welfare was a little bit, worked its way in a little bit later. Welfare cheaper is a more expansive term. If you look at Cooley, for example, Cooley's famous treatise, he spends a lot of time discussing police power and morals, far more than he does in economics, actually. And there Cooley's inclined to give a broad reading to police power, a more, much more narrow reading in the economic area. Okay, one or two last thoughts, because I know I'm about out of time. Oh, yeah, 1 whole minute left. Thank you. First, this was interesting because there's both federal and state contract laws. I know we're interested in this federalism dialogue here. So what did the state courts rely on? Now, I'm trying to be very mindful of this in my research. Some relied on both federal and state. Some just mentioned the federal. Some didn't make it clear which, but just that violates the obligation of contract. So I can't give you a 100% answer there. I'm particularly interested in that because later on, some state courts will suggest that they may have a broader, more protective contract clause than the federal. This will particularly come to the fore after later in our story, the federal government begins to chip away at the contract clause, virtually diluting it into a almost nothingness. Okay, lastly, this is the last point. Are there lessons for the future from this? Well, I'm not one of these people who think you can open a history book and say, wow, this answers all your contemporary problems. History's too messy for that. There's too many currents, and there's too many divisions of opinion, and too many nuances to say it's a one sentence. You can one sentence a lesson to the story. But I do think the antebellum period suggests that state courts are perhaps an underexplored avenue for people who wish to protect economic and property rights. And even in the contemporary context, I remind you that several state courts refused to follow Kelo. Some states adopted constitutional amendments to try to address the Kelo issue. I know they're not perfect. My friend Ilya Salman has pointed out some of them fell short. But nonetheless, there is an avenue ever of redress at the state level. So it would suggest there is indeed some vitality. And these areas could be explored further. And a few state courts have even said, well, the contract clause in our state means more than does the post-Blaisdell contract clause at the federal level. So don't give up the ship. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. So we're going to open up to questions, but I think before we do that, I'm going to just direct one question to each panelist, but I'll throw them both out at the same time, and you can each respond to one or both. So for Dan, you talked about the police power as something that doesn't follow from an abstract theory of governmental power, but we should think about it in terms of its relationship to our regulatory objectives and techniques, or where the legislature has a comparative advantage in overcoming collective action problems. And it occurs to me that some of these cases where we're litigating for liberty, a lot of it falls under that model. So the licensing regulations are an area where we think rent seeking is rampant, and so maybe it's where we think democratic procedures aren't well suited to regulate in that sort of area. But you don't normally go to a court and cite the public choice literature to say, you know, it should be outside the scope of the police power because we know from economics that it doesn't work as well in this context. So how would you think about it in terms of doctrine? Maybe it's the public purpose or something like that and so on.
Well,
okay, I guess I'll just do each question. That's fine. You can answer and then I'll do the next one.
Just very quickly, you got me in this sense. I elided, and purposely so, the question, even at the end, of what should be the connection between the phrase I kept using, how we ought to think about the police power and all, from judicial adjudication. And so I'd have to think a lot harder, and I'd say we'd all have think a lot harder about the relationship between, you know, a fancy theory or even a less fancy theory of what the functions and the purposes, to say nothing of the history, the police power should be about, and how they should be informed by modern public choice theory, by positive political theory, and by these other strands. And I think the answer, the punchline is they should be informed a great deal. The relationship between that and whether this creates judicially manageable standards. I tend to be on the side, although certainly not far on the side of those who believe in political safeguards and structural limits on the scope of powers, and more wary than I suspect some folks in the room, including my friends at the Institute for justice on the capacity and the desirability of courts in enforcing them. So I'll simply say that is a harder question, and I take the point and accept it, that you're really challenged when you start introducing in adjudication even the best literature on public choice theory and collective action, to say nothing of agglomeration economics and externalities and things that would make judges' eyes glaze over and blood run cold.
Thanks. And then for James, I just wanted to ask you to comment. It seemed like your paper gave us a kind of counterpoint to the critique we had this morning of romantic subnationalism, because you point out that state courts were interpreting some of the same language well before the U.S. Supreme Court addressed the language, or maybe even before we had the federal constitution. And so I'm wondering, I guess, two things. One, if the state traditions in that respect are a real strong basis for criticizing some of the directions in which the Supreme Court is going. The Supreme Court got it wrong by not listening to the state courts that it were interpreting for a long time. And then also, in terms of whether there are different traditions, do you find that the state courts were all converging on one view of the same text, or really did each state have a different soul?
Well, I'm very hesitant to get into the question of souls. I leave that more to my colleagues in the Divinity School. I would say that I think that there is not a marked divergence among the states with respect to some of the basic constitutional norms that I tried to articulate. In fact, in putting together this paper, I tried particularly to draw upon states throughout the area of antebellum America. We have had some historians who are very fond of basing their history on Massachusetts or New York, important jurisdictions to be sure, but not the entire United States. I wanted to make a conscious effort to get the entire geographic reach of the country involved. I thought, more similarity on norms. Naturally, there's room to differ as to how they should be applied in particular cases. Some states, I think, were more aggressive in the offset business than others. I did try to suggest that. That would be a difference. What might explain it? It could be degree of enthusiasm for projects. It could be a sense that money is very tight in the antebellum period, and we're looking for ways to encourage growth without making it too expensive. Some antebellum commentators thought that was what was going on, and I think there probably is at least some merit in that view. But I don't think I didn't find dramatic differences between the states on the issues that I was investigating.
All right, so we'll open up to questions from the audience. Steve Calabrese.
My question is for Dan and goes to whether the police power is irrepressible or whether there's a way to cabin it in. I assume the state police power cannot be more than the power that English monarchs acting together with the House of Lords and the House of Commons had in the 17th and 18th century, and because they were governments of general jurisdiction, not limited and enumerated powers. And there was an idea in the early 17th century that England was governed under an ancient constitution of which Magna Carta was only a part. The proponents of the ancient constitution included Sir Edward Coke. They argued that the English constitution went back to Edward the Confessor, and that the legis Edwardi, the laws of Edward the Confessor, really prevailed over anything that kings or queens could do. They also talked a great deal about how English liberties had been suppressed by the Normans, and it was necessary for the English to rise up against the yoke of the Norman oppression. Coke, in Dr. Bonham's case, considered occupational licensure. In Dr. Bonham's case, Parliament had chartered a college of physicians to license physicians to practice in London. Dr. Bonham, who had a medical degree from Cambridge, tried to become a member of the Board of Physicians. They denied him membership for anti-competitive reasons. He appealed to court, and Coke ruled in his favor, saying that even acts of Parliament contrary to the common law couldn't be sustained, and that there was a right to freedom of occupation that even Parliament couldn't invade. That principle didn't take hold in England, But it did take hold in the United States. The Massachusetts and Connecticut colonists were all full of Cook admirers and opponents of the Stuart kings. There's a little town outside New Haven, Connecticut called Cromwell, Connecticut, and that pretty much tells you what you need to know about what the New England colonists thought about this. But if there is an ancient constitution and a notion of ancient liberties, it would potentially apply to state police powers, and it would potentially suggest that maybe one could overthrow not only the yoke of the Norman oppression, but the yoke of the Progressive and New Deal oppressions as well. Any thoughts on this admittedly eccentric subject?
Well, I wouldn't describe it as that.
There's only certain can be on the same topic. Oh, yeah. You can just switch off your microphones and this one can.
I wouldn't describe it as eccentric as much as I would say that that wonderful exegesis is well above my pay grade. So, but I will add a footnote, and that and a doctrinal footnote, because I'm very sympathetic to what you describe, is, and you mentioned some of the thinking at the time of the framing and the early state constitutional adjudication. Makes a lot of sense to think that they would be influenced by, as you certainly have written and others. But what's fascinating to me, this is why it's a footnote, is even when you get to the 20th century, and now we're past the Civil War and Reconstruction, we're past the Progressive, pretty much past the Progressive era. I'm talking about the 19-teens and 20s. In doctrinal research that only a lawyer could love, I've actually looked at the police power cases in connection with parking, municipal parking regulation, right, where there actually was a really fascinating open question for about 15, 20 years about whether local governments could impose a parking meter, which was invented in Oklahoma City. And all of a sudden, you got all these challenges in state courts to, under the taxing authority and police power, about whether or not you can impose this fine through, for somebody for overstaying parking. And to a remarkable degree, the court, state courts were citing these English cases and the oppression of the king. They were regarding the parking meter as exactly like the oppression of the monarch and the king. So as late as the 1920s and 1930s, Bonham's case and others were alive and well in the jurisprudence of the police power.
My hypothesis is that originalism lives on as a manifestation of the ancient constitution idea.
Judge.
Yeah. We're now touching on something that I would want to maybe identify with perhaps a little more precision, if I may. Judge Smith mentioned it, and Professor Eli did, and now Professor Calabresi much the same. This symposium is termed state constitutionalism, but what I'm hearing is echoes and resonance of the common law. And when Professor Eli said earlier that James Kent, who was writing maybe about 1800 or in that vintage, could not draw on the Fifth Amendment because, as we know, it was not applicable to the states until later on the 14th Amendment, what did he have to rely on? Couldn't rely on the state constitution because those provisions did not come in to the state constitution until 1821 in New York State. So what is left? What's left, notably the common law, and Judge Smith rightfully was tweaking the California court for having no juridical basis to presage to presage Loving against Virginia, because they didn't rely on the state constitution. So what I'm asking and what I would appreciate some comment from the panelists is on is the role of common law here, in that, for example, Judge Smith and I sat together on the court, and there were a couple of instances in which, in the privacy realm, we decided that New York citizens should have, in essence, greater rights, to use a crass word, where the state constitution trumps the federal when it comes to greater rights. And I share Judge Smith's idea that we not just go crazy with this, but be very, very selective. But in a couple of cases, McIntosh and DeBoer, we did not rely on the state constitution at all. We accorded greater rights to citizens based strictly on what we declared to be the common law. So what I would maybe throw out here or ask is whether there could be yet another symposium, not Bob, to create more rights and have more and more people just go crazy declaring endless rights, but that the common law should be identified, if not equally with the state constitutions, but playing an important role. State constitution maybe a more permanent role, because when the judges declare that it's a state constitutional right that has more enduring, lasting, and important value than if they put it on common law, because then the legislature can come in and become sort of a turf war. But isn't the juridical foundation the same? Or isn't the common law an equally valid engine for expanding the rights of state citizens beyond what is accorded under the federal constitution? I'd be interested in whether the scholars here think that that might be underrated or not remarked on enough.
Well, let me take a stab at your very interesting question. I think we have to bear in mind that many of the constitutional provisions in the Bill of Rights and elsewhere, certainly many of those pertaining to property, were in fact originally common law norms that were constitutionalized. Certainly, William Blackstone, widely cited by judges of that generation, the antebellum generation, when, for example, the state constitution might say a person can't be deprived of property without the law of the land. What was the law of the land? Well, several courts said, well, the law of the land meant English common law, and who was the principal expositor, at least to that generation? William Blackstone. So they quote from Blackstone extensively. So they are, in a sense, moving toward a constitutionalization of common law. I would see no particular reason why a common law might not on its own also be interpreted to achieve same result. But I think that there was a tendency to blend common law and constitutional law throughout this period. And you'll see, now Blackstone, in my reading, was clearly talking about English common law when he writes about takings. But you see it progressively being moved into a constitutional context by courts throughout this period.
Can I just a sentence on that? I'm sympathetic to that view. One of the puzzles, though, that folks who work on state constitutionalism quite a bit and state constitutional doctrine raise in light of that is what to make of the fact that, as we know, state constitutions have a lot of different qualities than the national constitution, but two are profoundly important. One is they're so damn verbose, to put it mildly. They're extraordinarily long and detailed and very specific. So it raises the question of whether the common law in some sense has been displaced by the sheer prolixity of the documents. And the second is, and Judge Smith mentioned this, they're comparatively easy to amend. Some would take the comparatively out of that, say very easy to amend. So how that relates to common law when you have these constitutions that are amended frequently, and by the way, sometimes by straight direct initiative lawmaking, raises an interesting issue.
So I think we are out of time for this panel. We'll reconvene at 11:30, and please join me in thanking our panelists.
Yeah, I'm so glad you mentioned Justice Moore.